When our son was just a toddler, he was beginning to explore the wonders of the English language, and we faced some interesting times as a household growing up together. There was the time when word got around town that, and back to us, that when Nathan was asked what his dad did, he answered that his dad was the Methodist minister. Naturally, that didn't set too well with me. So when I asked him why he gave that answer, he told me it was because he couldn't say Presbyterian. Now, granted, Presbyterian is hard to say. It's hard to spell as well. So why do we bother ourselves and call ourselves that? Well, the root of the word Presbyterian comes from the Greek presbyteros, which means elder, and it's found in the book of Acts. And it describes the way that we govern ourselves after the pattern of governance that is laid out in the early church. You elect elders to represent you and make decisions for you. And of course, elder has the same root as the word elderly. And there's a disease of the eyes called presbyopia, which literally means old-sightedness. So there you have it. Presbyterians are old folks with bad eyes. Now, you can laugh at that, and I'm glad you did. But when you take those nuggets of priceless information and then you lay them across the pages of the Word of God, some wonderful truths emerge. This is Pentecost Sunday. Pentecost is a day for us to take God's word seriously when God says, "Behold, I make all things new." Pentecost is a day for us to do a vision check and start looking at the world around us in new ways. We don't have to settle for being old folks with bad eyes because God is changing. We do get used, of course, to looking at the world in old ways. Perhaps you picked that up in the attitude from Jesus' disciple Philip for this morning. He says, "Lord, show us the Father, and then we'll be satisfied." These disciples had been with Jesus for almost 3 years. They'd seen Jesus doing things that no one else could do, and all that time, Jesus had modeled for them what God was like. He'd given them a way to live, a way to walk, a way that would keep them in a relationship with God in this life and in the life to come. And still, Philip says, "Lord, show us the Father and we'll be satisfied." And here Jesus becomes very real and human for us. He says, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and still you do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father." How can you say, "Show us the Father"? In other words, Jesus is saying, "Phil, what more do you want?" Jesus was offering Philip a chance to see the world in a new way, but Philip was choosing to see the world through old eyes. And here we sit on Pentecost Sunday, and we find Jesus offering the same thing to you and me. Do you want to look at the world in a new way? Do you want to see through new eyes this morning? Sometimes I think we get so comfortable with the way things are that we resist even trying to see things differently. Perhaps more clearly. Perhaps more accurately, because it's just too hard. But just look at what Jesus offers his disciples. He says, "The one who believes in me will also do the works that I do. And in fact, will do greater works than these because I'm going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Father may be glorified in the Son." He says, "If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments." What a gift. And all we have to do is believe and step out and keep his commandments. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. If we just do that, Jesus says, we can do anything. So why do we struggle so much? Well, maybe it's because we haven't given up on the old eyes. For some reason, we just can't get it into our heads how much God loves us. We can't quite believe that God is there for us, quite like Jesus says God will be. And you know, Jesus is pretty sharp. He knew this would happen to the disciples. He knew that it would happen with us too. He knew that we wouldn't be able to see it on our own. So he made this promise. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of Truth. You see, there is a cure for old eyes. And the Spirit of God will show us the way. This is Pentecost Sunday. Each year we lift up this day and we celebrate the birthday of the church. Most years we read the story from the book of Acts where Luke describes what happened to the disciples that day. It's a great story about wind and flames and doors and windows bursting open. It talks about people pouring out into the streets and speaking in languages they didn't know they could speak, sharing the word of God in the story of Jesus' resurrection. It's an amazing and an exciting story. And it happened a long time ago. And you know, maybe that's the problem. The church was born way back then. And this morning we observe an anniversary, and then we close the book for another year. We catch a glimpse of the power of the Spirit of God that Jesus promises his followers. But, you know, then we go back to looking at our world through the same old eyes again. We just can't quite see what God has planned for us. It's kind of fuzzy. It's those old eyes again. So this morning I challenge you to make today different. Let's do something about these old eyes. Let's pay a visit to Dr. Paul. The words in his letter to the Christians in Rome can clear our vision in a hurry. Here's what he says. All who are led by the Spirit, which I think that means you and me, all who are led by the Spirit are children of God. That's where it begins. The promised Spirit is who brought you here this morning. I believe that something is going on here, that God is at work. Just like this communion table spread in front of you for celebration, God is laying out a life before each one of you. Are you going to risk letting the Spirit open your eyes to this new thing that God is offering you? Again, listen to what God is saying to you through Paul's words this morning. At this moment, right now, Paul writes, "For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption." Paul says, don't let fear hold you back. That's the world's way. That's the spirit of slavery. Looking through those old eyes will only cause you to fall back into fear. And you know, that's exactly where so many voices out there want you to be, in fear. Folks want you to be afraid. Because when you're afraid, they know that you'll believe just about anything. You will do just about anything. And that's not where God wants you to be. That's why God has given us the Holy Spirit. This Pentecost Sunday can be more than just the celebration of a birth that happened 2,000 years ago when a few followers offered good news that changed the world. Today can be your day of celebration this morning too. Your day to celebrate a new birth as that very same Spirit takes root in your life. That Spirit gives us new eyes to see God working in the world around us in new ways. We don't have to be afraid. Long ago, the writer of Psalms gave us these words. Some of you may know them by heart. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? That is the work of the Holy Spirit in your life and in mine. That Spirit has made us children of God. Paul says that we have been adopted into the family. And this morning, the Father invites the kids to come to the table and share a meal together. And as you come, I want you to think about what that means for you. And let fear fall away. And with new eyes, seeing the Spirit with you, do the work that God has called you to do. And child of God, church of God, happy birthday to you. Amen. Would you pray with me? Our gracious God, we thank you for the gift of life, the gift of joy, the gift of anticipation, and the power of that love which can drive out all fear. You have adopted us. We are heirs to your kingdom right beside Jesus Christ our Lord. And may we live that life of faith and live it in confidence as we come to your table to celebrate today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.